In this video, we're talking about electrons and atoms and where they are in the atom and how we can label them. So it ends up that when an electron is in an atom, it occupies a level or a shell. And we label these levels or shells with the letter N, and it can have an integer. It's equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And if we imagine the nucleus as being down here, then each level or shell is going out from the nucleus. And the farther that level or shell is from the nucleus, the higher its energy. So an electron can be at n equals 1 shell or level, the n equals 2 level, 3, 4. Now, the higher it is, the higher its energy. So higher n means higher energy. Now, within each level or shell, it's divided farther, more finely, into sublevels or subshells. So it ends up that at n equals 1, there's only one subshell, one sublevel. And that's called the 1s sublevel. The 1 in front here tells us what n is. This 1 is this one here. And s tells us the sublevel. Now, when n is equal to 2 out there, there are two subshells, the 2s subshell and the 2p subshell. The 2 here tells us n is equal to 2, and so does it as it does here. Now notice that the p subshell at n equals 2 is a little bit higher in energy than the s subshell at n equals 2. Now when we get to n equals 3, there are 3 sublevels, and it continues like that. At n equals 4, there are 4 sublevels, and so on. At n equals 3, there is the 3s sublevel, the 3p sublevel, and the 3d sublevel. All these are 3 because it's n equals to 3. And here the 3s sublevel is a little bit lower in energy than the 3p, which is a little bit lower in energy than the 3d. When we get out to the n equals 4, I didn't show it here, but there's a 4s, a 4p, a 4d, and after d comes an f. There's a 4f sublevel starting at n equals 4. So at each n, as n gets bigger, each time n goes up by 1, we get one more sublevel in that shell or that level. Now within each of these sublevels or subshells, there are what we call orbitals. And what an orbital is, it's a place where an electron has a high probability of existing. Where? Now, whenever there's an s sublevel, there's only one orbital, and we call it an s orbital. It has the same name as the sublevel. Whenever there's a p sublevel, there are 3 p orbitals. D, there are 5, and in an f sublevel, there are 7. So you should know these numbers. So if we go back here, there's just an s sublevel, and there's one orbital here. In this 2s sublevel, there's one 2s orbital. But in this 2p sublevel, there are 3 orbitals, all with the same energy. They're called 2p orbitals. Then again, out here at n equals 3, there's one 3s orbital. There are 3 3p orbitals and 5 3d orbitals. And it continues like that. Now, this is what the orbitals look like. Every time it's an s orbital, which is always in an s sublevel, it's a sphere. Okay, and this is where the electron can be. The only thing is that as you go farther out from the nucleus, as n gets bigger, the orbital gets bigger, goes out farther from the nucleus. So 1s is a tight orbital, right by the nucleus there. 2s, the electron's farther out. 3s, it's even farther out. These are what the p orbitals look like in any p sublevel. Remember, in any p sublevel, there are 3 of those p orbitals. And this just happens to be the n equals 2, but it could be, they look just like this at n equals 3, 4, and so on. It's just that as n gets bigger, these also get bigger. Don't worry really about the x, y, and z here. The idea is that this is pretty much the shape, and there are 3 of those. Now, when you combine them all together, it kind of looks a little confusing, but they're all centered on the nucleus. The nucleus would be right here. There's one of them, there's another one, and there's another one. D orbitals start getting even more crazy, and Fs I'm not going to even show you those. It doesn't really matter what they look like. The important thing for us is that every time there's an s sublevel, there's only one s orbital. Every time there's a p sublevel, there are three p orbitals. In a d sublevel, there are five d orbitals. And in an f sublevel, there are seven f orbitals. And that's as far as we need to go with the orbitals. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to start putting electrons into atoms and see where they go. And maybe the picture is kind of like if you imagine that you have this atom that's empty, has no electrons in it. We have a bucket over there by us that has electrons in it. We're going to reach out one at a time and drop these electrons into the atom. And those electrons are going to fall down until they get to the lowest energy orbital that has room. And that's where they're going to stay. So that's one of the rules, is that when we're putting electrons into atoms, they always go into the lowest energy orbital that has room. Now, this diagram right here shows you the relative energies of the orbitals. So 1s, 2s, 2p, then 3s, then 3p, then 4s. Now, up to this point, you'll notice that, you know, there's the 1s, n equals 1, n equals 2, 2s and 2p, n equals 3, 3s and pp. Excuse me, 3s and 3p. But look at this, the 4s is actually lower in energy than the 3d, and that's just the way it is. So at this point, just remember that. 4s, 3d, 4p, 5s. Now, there's a couple of other rules. One says that the maximum number of electrons that there can be in any single orbital is 2. And if they are, they have to have what we call opposite spins. Now, it ends up that electrons act as if they're this little spinning sphere of negative electric charge. And that spin can be either pointing up or pointing down. It doesn't matter which is which. The only thing we care about with this spin is that if there are two electrons in the exact same orbital, they have to be in opposite directions. Now, in this diagram here, each of these little boxes represents an orbital. Remember, these are all the s orbitals, and there's only one s orbital in an s sublevel. These are all the p orbitals, and there's three boxes because there are three p orbitals in each p sublevel. Five boxes for the d's, seven for the f's. Notice this also. At n equals 1, there's only an s sublevel. N equals 2, there's an s and a p. 3, there's an s, a p, and a d. 4, there's an s, a p, a d, and an f. And we don't need to go any past that. So, lowest energy orbital that has room, and no more than two electrons in the same orbital. If they are, they have to have opposite spins. Now, what we do to show that is we use these arrows to represent electrons. So, this right here is what we call an energy level diagram, an orbital energy level diagram. And this is for hydrogen. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take the neutral atom. Now, remember, we can look at the periodic table and we can tell how many electrons there are in any neutral atom just by looking at the atomic number. Hydrogen's atomic number is 1, there's 1 proton. So for it to be neutral, there has to be 1 electron. And that electron will go into the lowest energy orbital that has room. Now, if you remember back to that diagram, the lowest energy orbital was the 1s. And so we just put one arrow. Doesn't matter if this one's pointing up or down, by the way, because it's the only one in there. And this is what the energy level diagram would look like for hydrogen. We call this the ground state. Ground state because if we put more energy in, we can take this electron and pop it up here to another one, but we're not going to worry about that yet. And we can also write what is called an electron configuration. This right here is an electron configuration, 1s1. This 1 in the front tells us that its n is equal to 1. The s tells us what the sublevel is, the s sublevel. And the superscript tells us how many electrons there are in that sublevel. So there's 1 electron in the 1s sublevel in that orbital there. Now helium, its atomic number is 2, so the neutral helium atom has 2 electrons. Well, the 1s orbital has room for 2, so we can put the second electron into here. Now notice the arrows are pointing in opposite directions. That's the only important thing, is that they're opposite directions. Doesn't matter which is up, which is down. Just one's up and one's down. And the electron configuration for neutral helium would be 1s2. N is equal to 1, it's the s sublevel, and there are 2 electrons in there, 1, 2. Lithium has an atomic number of 3. So now, because the 1s sublevel is full, we can't fit any more electrons in there. The next lowest energy level is the 2s. And so we put that third electron right here. Neutral lithium has 3 electrons. And we write its electron configuration as 1s2, 2s1. So 2 electrons in the 1s sublevel and 1 electron in the 2s sublevel. Beryllium, 4 electrons in the neutral atom. 2 of them go into the 1s sublevel. We can fit 2 into the 2s with opposite spins. And its electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2. And now these 2 sublevels are full, so the next place we put electrons are going to be in the 2p sublevel. So for boron, which has 5 electrons, we put 2 in the 1s, and then it's full. 2 in the 2s, now it's full. Now that last electron goes up in the 2p. Now, here's the thing. It doesn't matter which of these 3 orbitals you put this electron in, and it doesn't matter what its spin is. But once you put this electron in here, if we put any more electrons into this sublevel, whatever spin this first electron has, either up or down, the next 2 have to have that same spin pointing the same direction, and they have to each go into one of the unoccupied orbitals. Got that? When you're putting electrons into orbitals that are at the same sublevel, the same energy level, 2p, or it could be 3d, or what have you, 3p, doesn't matter. You put one electron into each empty orbital, all with the same spin. Doesn't matter up or down, but they all have to be the same until you start pairing them up. So boron's electron configuration would be 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. Carbon, one more electron. Here we go. We put that next electron into one of these other 2 orbitals. It didn't matter which. But if this first one is spin down, this one has to be spin down. If I had written this spin up, this would have to be spin up. Doesn't matter, as long as they're the same. And carbon's electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Nitrogen, we put that next electron into the last unoccupied orbital. All these 3 have the same spin, and there's 1 in each. Nitrogen's electron configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Then when we get to oxygen, now because all of these 3 orbitals each have 1 electron in them, now we can start pairing them up and putting that second electron in, and it has to have the opposite spin. I could have put this last electron for oxygen here or here, it doesn't matter. Now, last thing here, core notation, or also called abbreviated notation or noble gas notation. It's just a shorthand, and if you look at helium's electron configuration, it's 1s2. Lithium is 1s2, 2s1. So what we can do is we can write as its electron configuration helium, which is 1s2, and then we write 2s1 outside of here. That would be the core noble gas notation for lithium. Now, here's the thing. It can only be a noble gas that we put in these square brackets here. And so if we go through the periodic table and we get past neon, we go to sodium or magnesium or what have you, then we can put neon in these square brackets. And we'll see this in the next video.